People them, better people them hear your voice, Mr. Omar.
Absolutely, absolutely. Black power, love to the entire African New York City family. Shout out to the Bronx. Shout out to Brooklyn, Staten Island, Harlem, Queens, all points beyond. A big shout out to you, my brother, for having me back on the interview, on the radio. And we want to let the whole family know this Friday, in 3 days, Friday, October the 30th, Dr. Umar will be celebrating his 10th anniversary.
10th.
From the first day he spoke in New York City. That was October 30th, 2010, at the National Black Theater in Harlem. That was the first time New York City ever had a chance to hear and meet Dr. Umar live and in person. And this Friday, October the 30th, will be 10 long years of coming to New York, speaking, building, organizing, networking, helping the parents, saving the children. And I'm just hoping all the brothers and sisters will come out on Friday and show me love as I release my new book for the very first time in New York City, Black Parent Advocate, The Art of War for Dealing with America's Public and Charter Schools.
Yep.
I will be signing books from 2 p.m. until 8 p.m. It's not a lecture. It's not a lecture. It's a drop-in book signing from 2 p.m. until 8 p.m. And we will be at the Fun Times Paint Lounge at 1148 Nostrand Avenue. Again, that's the Fun Times Paint Lounge in Brooklyn.
Yep.
This Friday, 1148 Nostrand Avenue. Come through, give me a hug, take a picture, ask a question. Most of all, buy a book and get one signed.
Wow, wow. And is this one of your first project, or is this your first book, or you have more in store?
It's the second book. It's not the last, by no means. My next project is, first of all, I have to update the first book, Psychoacademic Holocaust, The Special Education and ADHD Wars Against Black Boys. That released in New York City. New York was the first city to get that book on March the 6th. Of 2013, 7 years ago. New York was the first to get that book. Black Parent Advocate, the new book, released in Chicago on September the 18th, 3 weeks ago, which was my 10-year anniversary in Chicago. Just to give you a little piece of history, DJ, when I blew up in black consciousness on the national and global scene, in 2010, it started off with a public television interview in Chicago on September the 18th. And then my next stop after that was Harlem on October the 30th. So we've already celebrated my 10-year anniversary in Chicago on September the 18th. And now it's time to celebrate my 10-year anniversary in New York City, October the 30th. So I'm basically going back over that victory trail all over again, because when I leave you guys, I then go down to Virginia to honor Nat Turner on the day that Nat Turner was killed, executed after leading the most daring revolution in American history in Nat Turner Land, Virginia. So I'll be down there on Wednesday, November the 11th, and that'll be my 10th year going to Nat Turner. And then I go to Atlanta, Georgia on Thursday, November the 19th.
Yeah.
That'll be my 10th anniversary in Atlanta, and we will end the anniversary tour in Fort Lauderdale, Florida on Thursday, December the 10th. So we have 5 anniversaries: Chicago, New York this Friday, Nat Turner Land, Atlanta, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. So this is the 10-year anniversary tour. But it all started with Chicago and New York City. If it wasn't for Chicago and New York City, I would not be King Kong consciousness.
So how was that first book? How did it did in the stores, and what was that first book about? Could you elaborate on that?
First book, Psychoacademic Holocaust. And let me say this as a preface to answering your question. I want all of our African parents, our Brooklyn African parents, our Staten Island African parents, our Queens African parents, our Bronx African parents, our Harlem African parents, our Yonkers African parents, our New Roselle African parents, our Caribbean African parents, our Jamaican African parents, our Haitian African parents, our Nigerian African parents, they all need to get this book, DJ, because what I'm seeing in the schools, and this is answering that question, is our Caribbean African parents who live in New York City, New Jersey, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania, they are at an even greater disadvantage than the American African parents, because the schools don't expect the Jamaican African parents, the Puerto Rican African parents, the Haitian African parents. They don't expect the Bahamian African parents, the Nigerian African parents, the Senegalese African parents. They don't expect them to know their rights at all. See, with the American African parents, they say some of them might know what's going on, yeah, but most of them don't. But when that Jamaican African parent walks into that public school in New York City, when that Liberian African parent walks into that public school in New York City, they are almost certain that those parents don't know the school law, that they don't know educational process, that they don't know special ed policy. And so this new book, and I'm going to come right back to that first one, this new book picks up where the first one left off. So let's go to the first book. That's your question.
Yeah.
Psychoacademic Holocaust provides an overall breakdown and analysis of how the school to prison pipeline operates. It talks about six key areas, DJ. There are six stages in America's psychoacademic Holocaust against black boys. Stage one, deliberate and intentional miseducation. This is on purpose. It is by design. It is with deliberate intent. It has nothing to do with sagging pants. It has nothing to do with football. It has nothing to do with single mothers. It has nothing to do with incarcerated fathers. And I say that, DJ, because if you go to a rich upper class black public, if you go to a rich upper class white public school district,
yeah,
that has black children, whose father might be a doctor and mother might be a lawyer, they still go through the same hell. So it is socioeconomically neutral. It applies to all black boys, whether your parents make $1 million a year and are married, or whether you're living with a single mom in the projects in Brooklyn. It's the same. And the reason, stage one, the reason miseducation at stage one is so important, DJ, is because it guarantees that white privilege for white boys and white girls is always protected and maintained. In yeah. other words, you must deliberately sabotage the education of black children to guarantee white priority and privilege. That's stage one.
Yeah,
ready for stage two?
Before you go to stage two, let me say something about that. My friend here, K9, is here inside the studio with us, and we said that you said that the white privilege, they have a code. They have a code. Whenever they meet or whenever they see each other in the street, even foreigners and European, whenever they see each other in the street, they know the era code. They know the code. They stick together. I don't know why we don't have that bond, because they have that white privilege over us. No matter how you see a young kid driving a car, I don't want to be racist or political or whatever, but sometimes you see a white kid driving a car and don't have a driver's license. You don't have the proper paperwork for it. But if a policeman pull over and he's white and the two of them white, the both of them know the code. You understand what I mean? When you say white privilege. But let's go back to what you were trying to say.
Absolutely. And see here, DJ, this is where all of us as Africans globally often get distracted and sidetracked when we talk about racism. So, for example, and we don't want to get off task because we want to stay focused on our children, but I want to draw a quick segue over to the current presidential race. Donald Trump has a platinum package for American Africans, a platinum package. But what a lot of black people are not paying attention to is the Hispanic Prosperity Initiative that President Trump signed about a month ago. If you compare the Hispanic Prosperity Bill to the American African Platinum Package, they're like night and day. He's guaranteeing the Hispanics improved education. Yeah. He's guaranteeing them as a group improve economic opportunity.
Wow.
See, although he talks about economics in the Platinum Package, and he may talk about education in the Platinum Package, the biggest difference between Donald Trump's Hispanic Prosperity Bill and the African American Platinum Package, the biggest difference, DJ, is that the Hispanic plan is supposed to systematically address the Hispanic reality as a group, as a people, whereas the African American Platinum Package, that's going to give certain opportunities to certain Negroes. This is where we get messed up. This is where we get messed up. We will settle for that because we're so selfish and only concerned about our individual progress that we won't even recognize Donald Trump is running a scam. Donald Trump is going to guarantee certain opportunities for a limited number of black people. This is the point we must understand. He's going to make sure a certain number of black people will get those resources.
Okay.
But most black people will not be helped.
Oh,
with
so
the Hispanic community, he's going to systematically address their problems as a community, not as individuals. And that's the difference.
Oh, so he's separating. It's like you have white chicken and you have sensor chicken. You know, he might separate the genge for them, the ends them from the rooster. So he might make some special and some feel little special and some.
Absolutely. Because here's the thing. If you didn't plan to treat the groups differently, you would have never separated out the two plans. He would have never separated out the two plans. The reason they're separate is because they're not of the same quality.
Mm.
The reason they're separate is because they're not of the same quality. What he's going to do for the Hispanics is not what he's going to do for blacks.
Okay.
Nor can it be. Because black people, as an unwritten policy, can never be specifically targeted for governmental assistance. This is important to understand. That's why reparations is such a big issue. Because reparations specifically distinguishes American Africans for the unique experience and trauma that they had endured in this country. That's a problem for America because America doesn't do anything for black people alone. That's why they always like to add us into the minority group, the people of color group, the socially disadvantaged. The labels that they use to describe black people must necessarily always include other non-white people. Let me say that again. The words that they use to describe American Africans must necessarily include other non-white people as a means of making sure You look like you're going to help black people, but you're really going to give all the resources away to another group. So, for example, with affirmative action, it looked like it was for black people. But the 1964 Civil Rights Bill included homosexuals and lesbians, as well as women. So gender and sexual preference were added to African American. It was added to the minority definition. So they were able to give all of those benefits to gays and white women.
Yeah.
And we got almost nothing out of it because the definition includes other non-whites.
Yeah, they tricked
us. The only way it can only be for us is if we stand up unapologetically, DJ. We have to stand up unapologetically and say any bill for us must be exclusively for us, not minorities, not disadvantaged, not people of color, but for blacks or American Africans. But we don't do that because we want to be accepted by the other groups. We have low African self-esteem, so we want to fit in with the other groups. And so the government never has to be accountable to black people exclusively because we would much rather blend in with the other non-whites to hide our embarrassment for being black.
Wow. All right. We know we do. Time is against us and time goes so fast. New York Tri-State is exactly 7:41 on the Richter scale. I go to commercial at 8 o'clock. And then we will continue back with the interview. But doctor, I want to ask you a question. Do you think that now that they have this thing that they have where they call it corona, do you think that they use this as a way to divide us from, because they're doing school now in your house, virtual learning. And you're trying to build a school, and you see that they mess us up again. They throw a hardball there, so now the kids are learning from their home. They're not even going to school no more. So even the school that you're trying to build, they kind of silently shut it down because school is going to virtual. In the future, I think that's what school's going to be. It's not going to be no more building, no more janitor, no more. You know, need an electrician, a plumber. All you gotta do is just go on your laptop and talk to a computer, which is a robot somewhere trying to teach your kid if you want to learn. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Let me say this to that, and that's a very good point that you're raising there, brother. Let me first say to all your listeners who are hearing Dr. Umar for the first time, who may have never heard of me before, and for those returning listeners who happen to catch me tonight, and for those who I look forward to seeing on Friday who are going to come and support me by buying the new book and support their children, because the book is for them, not for me.
Yes.
It's almost 600 pages, DJ. Let me say that again. 600 pages. It's thicker than your Holy Bible.
Is it?
That's how much information.
You could get it on CD too? So if you're driving it. In the car, you could listen to it?
Not yet. Not audio. That's in the plans, but that's at least a year away from now.
Okay.
Because that would be a lot of discs. Oh. That would be a lot of discs. But I love to talk, and so I do see that coming in the future.
Yeah.
But let me say this. For those, the school that you're speaking of, the school that the brother is speaking of to the listening audience, is the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey RBG International Leadership Academy for Pan-African Excellence.
Yeah.
It is a school that will be the first in American history designed specifically to teach black boys how to be revolutionary Pan-African nationalists, nation builders, and masters of money, economic experts. We are trying to raise a generation of alpha male leaders who have African independence as their priority and the protection of African women and the building of the African nation as their mission. This school is the first of its kind in African history globally. Not only will it be the first of its kind in America, it'll be the first of its kind in the world for our people, and then we hope to move them all over the country. But the point I want to say to them is this, Brother DJ.
Yeah.
Right now, we are renovating the smaller school on the campus. We have four buildings. It's a four-building campus. Two of them are schools. One is an elementary school, and one is a much larger high school. We're renovating the elementary school right now as we speak. In order to successfully complete that renovation, I need your listeners to donate to the FDMG cause. They can do it four ways.
Yep.
Number one, get on your Cash App.
Dollar sign
FDMG school on your Cash App.
You hear that, New York?
Dollar sign FDMG school on your Cash App.
Cash App.
That's number one. Get on the Cash App. Dollar sign FDMG school on the Cash App. Number two, on your PayPal. If you use PayPal, especially for your international listeners, because Cash App, I believe, is only a domestic money transfer.
Yeah.
Internationally, they have to use PayPal. And the link to donate internationally is paypal.me/FDMG Academy. paypal.me/FDMG Academy. So for PayPal, it's FDMG Academy. For the Cash App, it's $FDMG School. And then they can also mail their donations payable to the FDMG Academy to P.O. Box 9634 Wilmington, Delaware. I repeat, P.O. Box 9634 Wilmington, Delaware, 19809. The other way they can donate is when they come to Brooklyn, 1148 Nostrand Avenue, this Friday, October the 30th, from 2 until 8, to pick up their book. They can bring their donation at that time in an envelope, check or money order. We don't want cash. Check or money order. We don't want cash, with their name and address on it, and they can hand that directly to Dr. Umar. But let me say this quickly, DJ. If they go to my website,
yeah,
drumarjohnson.com. If they go to drumarjohnson.com, they can join our Loyal Donors Club that we just started this month. The Loyal Donors Club allows you to automatically contribute on the same day of every month the same amount of money. We have a Bronze Club, $50 a month. Silver Club, $100 a month. Gold Club, $250 a month. Platinum Club, $500 a month. In Diamond Club, $1,000 a month. So they can go to the website, and they can also just click on that and donate through the website as well if they didn't get all the information that I just shared.
Wow. Okay, let me ask you one question. Do you think it's a right move to make? You are a born American, true?
American African.
Do you feel it's right to make a school right here in America, or you think we should try go back to Africa and try to educate ourselves from our black roots? Because if the way they're designing America right now, if we're not careful, they're going to put in a new device in us, where they call the vaccine, which is like an antenna for their little works that they're coming up with, where you can see what you do, see what you buy, where you're at with this new vaccine that they're implementing, because that's what they're trying to do with us. So I was thinking, do you think that, is it safe for us as black people to stay here, or we should do like Marcus Garvey say, pack up and go back to Africa and build from there?
Without question, repatriation is the only thing that's going to hold off extermination. America is in the process of exterminating the American African.
Yeah.
So they don't care if it's the Caribbean African in America. They don't care if it's the Ghanaian African in America. They don't care if it's the American African who descended from those who were brought from the continent. They have a plan to exterminate all 50 million of us.
Yeah.
Okay. So without question, the solution is repatriation. We know that. That is crystal clear for me as a revolutionary pan-African nationalist, as a Garveyite. There's no other solution but to go home.
Yeah.
So then you may ask the follow-up question. If the solution is to go home, Dr. Umar, why did you choose to buy a campus in Wilmington, Delaware, for your first school as opposed to putting it in Africa?
Yeah.
The answer to that is rooted in the fact that I cannot turn my back on the black boys and black girls here in the United States. Although I'm ready for repatriation, although that is in my future, I am still the foremost school psychologist of my people here. I am still one of the foremost educators of my people here.
Yeah.
I am still the foremost conscious orator, speaker, scholar, intellectual right here. To get up and leave, to abandon the American African portion of the global African struggle, to abandon the American African portion of the global African struggle would not sit right with my soul. And it would not sit right with my Pan-Africanist ancestors, all of whom, from the most honorable Marcus Garvey to Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, down to Robert Sobukwe to Julius Nyerere, all of them, we always believe as Pan-Africanists. Although we have a global goal to get back to Africa and to build up Africa and to unite Africa, we still have to solve and face the problems where we are. Pan-Africanism is not an escapist ideology that says forget about this, it's useless, and run away. The goal is Africa, global unification of the global African family, but I still must cast my bucket down where I am and do what I can to fight for my brothers and sisters here. One day I will be in Africa. But my responsibility to the American African nation is to make sure I leave an institution here for our children also.
Okay. K9 is my partner in crime. Is we going to be coming to Delaware with us? It's going to come in with,
yes,
with Delaware. You say want to ask that question. But New York is exactly 7:52 on the Richter scale. You know the computer kicks in at 8 o'clock. The computer kicks in at 8 o'clock. We go to commercial, and then we come back and continue the commercial, New York Tri-State. K9, ask the question that you want to ask.
Good evening, Doc.
Good evening, my brother.
Right. Question. What can we do in the meantime to come together at this time, the time we're living in? What can we do for us, to strengthen us as a people, so we can, so the battle not so as bad as it's supposed to be?
Absolutely. The first two steps of any liberation movement, I don't care if you look at the Chinese Revolution, I don't care if you look at the American Revolution, I don't care if you look at the Haitian Revolution, if you look at the African independence revolutions, the first two steps of any revolution are education and economics. Education and economics. We're working on the education with FDMG. We're working on the education with the National Independent Black Parents Association. We're working on the education with the new Black Parent Advocate Bible that everybody's going to come get this Friday in Brooklyn. On the economic side, the best thing that we can do on the economic side for those Africans who live in the West, all of us, from Canada down to the tip of South America into the Caribbean Ocean, all the Caribbean islands, we have to organize ourselves economically so that we can invest in Africa's liberation, and by doing so, invest in our own. The biggest mistake that the Western Hemisphere African is making right now is that we are not looking at the greater goal. We are ignoring the fact that we have an opportunity right now to invest in Africa so Africa can in turn invest in us. It doesn't make any sense that the richest continent on the planet is being ignored by the richest African population in the Western Hemisphere. The American African, in terms of income, is the richest African in the world in terms of income. But we are not tying the wealth of the richest population to the richest continent. We should be investing in all things African. We should be investing in African technology. We should be investing in African solar energy. We should be investing in African farmland. We should be investing in African poultry. We should be investing in African education. We should be investing in building independent African communities on the continent. We are selling Africa out. Let me be clear. All of us are guilty of treason. Every African in the Western world is guilty of treason because we see what the Anglo-Saxon is doing and we see what the Chinese are doing, and we're not using our money at all as a weapon to destroy the neocolonialism of the mother continent by the European and the Chinaman. That makes us guilty of treason.
Wow. New York Tri-State is exactly 7:55 on the Richter scale. The computer will chip in at 8 o'clock. The computer will chip in at 8 o'clock, and we will continue this conversation that we're having with Dr. Omar Johnson. New York, call a friend, tell a friend that we're talking to Dr. Omar Johnson. He's having his book, his second book launch right here in Brooklyn this Friday. That's not what's the address, Mr. Omar?
1148
Nostrand Avenue, New York Tri-State. Come on out and celebrate with him. He's celebrating 10 years. You say 10 years for this book. Your first one was 2013, and this is your second one. So New York Tri-State, I'm asking you, if you can donate, cash up, anywhere you can, to walk, run, put a little 10 cent, a little 5 cent, put something in your pocket. Even if you can't read the book, because a lot of us cannot read so well. Even if you cannot read the book, you can just donate something towards the building the school. Because the school that he's building, trust me, he need a lot of help. He need a lot of help with this school. This school is not a chicken feed. It's not a walk in the park. So it's not like, say, he's going to put all the money in his pocket. He's doing something for better us and better our community and people, our environment, and make we have a better place for a better tomorrow. We got exactly 3 minutes before we go to commercial. I can't stop saying because trust me, the computer will kick in no time, and then we'll be off the air and we'll come back after commercial. But what I'm trying to say is, New York, come on out this Friday, the 30th of October, is going to be book signing for his new book, his second book. So come on out, kids, family, friend, you know, come take a picture, come meet the man of the moment. He's working so hard for us. One thing I want to ask you, though, on that school, do you have a farm on that school?
There is no farm on the school campus. But we plan to purchase farmland. We're currently looking at farmland for sale in southern New Jersey, because we're on the border, southern Pennsylvania, we're on the border, and also in Delaware proper. We're looking for farmland. We're also considering an urban garden, but we would prefer to have a much larger operation because we have a lot of Black farmers, conscious Black farmers, many of them are elders around the country who want to get involved in the FDMG Farm Cooperative.
Wow, that's nice. And you know that farming play a good part in the Black community, because eating right is one of our main source. We have to change our eating habits. We have to, because we're dying by diabetes, cancer, and all these things, these processed foods. So we have to farm our own food so we can eat right.
Absolutely. And we plan to have our own farmers market outside the school once a month so the children can sell the fruits and vegetables to the community at a discounted price. That money will go to help us fund the operation, so they benefit by having nutritious food, and we benefit by having funds to help us keep the operation up and running. Let me say this quickly, because I know we're up against that moment.
Anyone
who wants to be a part of the Team Pan-African movement, come out Friday and let me know who you are. Introduce yourself. Dr. Umar, I can help with this. I have expertise in this. I want to know what people can do.
Are you looking for a great tasting authentic Jamaican rum punch? Well, here it is, Flourish Rum Tom. I said it correctly.